Right, guys, thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. I know conditions are a little bit tricky for everyone around the world. Lots of people working from home. Everyone, please do stay safe as well. My name is Leo Smith. So I'm going to be hosting today's webinar. So this is part two on how to image a disk with Macrium Reflect. We did go through part one last month, which you can still find on our YouTube channel. Today we're going to be covering a lot of our main features, but I'll go through the agenda just to show you guys what we'll be covering today. We'll also be taking through the demo of how to use these features by my colleague Jack Mansfield, who's representing our technical engineering team today. Right, guys, so just to run through the agenda, so we're going to be having a look at Macrium at a glance, so what Macrium does, of course having a look at what disk imaging is and what we mean by disk imaging. People tend to get imaging and cloning confused, so we're just going to sort of clarify that a little bit as well. We do have a couple of advanced features on Macrium that we'll be running through, so we'll be going through that plus other products that you might be interested in as well. And then finally, at the end, we will have a Q&A period where you can feel free to unmute and ask a question. Any questions you do think of throughout the webinar, as I mentioned, please do put in the chat box. I will be running through them at the end as well. And just obviously knowing that not everyone would have the opportunity to speak. So Macrium Reflect. So Macrium, we are an image-based backup and cloning solution for commercial and personal use. We currently have over 8 million downloads worldwide. And of course, what Macrium means to do is protect your data, typically used to upgrade your hard disk, and of course, clone operating systems as well. Now, disk imaging, our sort of definition of disk imaging and what I mean by that. So Macrium Reflect actually creates an accurate, complete image of a hard disk or the partitions on the disk. So in the event of a partial or complete systems loss, you can use this image to restore the entire disk or one or more partition or individual files and folders as well. So the particular files that you want to recover, you're able to do that with Macrium Reflect. Some of the advanced features that we're going to be going through today is Image Guardian, which will basically be there to protect any backup files that you do have. viBoot, Rapid Delta Cloning, Rapid Delta Restore, Change Block Tracking, and Macrium Redeployment. So we'll be going through those in a little bit more detail, and Jack will actually take you through how to use those features on the Macrium software. So Image Guardian. So what typically Image Guardian does is it's there to protect your backup files from unauthorized modification. So not to confuse it with actual malware, which is obviously there to protect everything on your laptop or PCs. Macrium Image Guardian basically focuses on your backup. So if you guys do have anything backed up using Macrium, it's almost another sort of gatekeeper added layer of protection to stop anything corrupting it that you do have saved. So if anything is trying to alter those backup files or those images and hasn't come through Macrium, Image Guardian is there to protect it and stop it. Macrium viBoot is actually quite a nice little feature that we have as well. Macrium viBoot will allow and enable you to instantly create a start manage as well. Any backups that you do have through Microsoft Hyper-V. So ultimately what it is if you guys do find yourselves in a situation where, you know, computer's completely crashed, you have got a backup image file, but time of the essence and you need to get started straight away. What Macrium viBoot allows you to do is to boot that last image that you've taken into a virtual machine and allow you to obviously start running your own computer from another laptop or PC, saving you obviously some of that critical time that you may have lost while your actual physical machine is corrupted or damaged in any way. So allowing you to still obviously continue working whilst that's being repaired, which again, it will probably be something that might be quite key in this current environment with obviously everyone working from home. People probably haven't touched their home laptops or used them for work in such a long time that, you know, it could be damaged in a sort of way. So again, this may be a very key feature to look at. Rapid Delta Cloning. So Macrium Rapid Delta Cloning offers a performance increase as an incremental disk image offers over a full image and enables regular clones to be a viable and fast disaster recovery solution. So once again, Macrium Rapid Delta Cloning is there to sort of increase that that speed and performance when taking backups. Incremental images, I know incrementals are quite key in these day and age, and a lot of people like taking incrementals because it just basically saves and records the changes that you've made from your last sort of full image or last differential that you've taken. And when you're backing up, that's obviously going to reduce a lot of disk space, and it's going to be a lot quicker as well in terms of the speed in which it backs up your system. Rapid Delta Restore is just the other side of it. Macrium Rapid Delta Restore is not dependent on VSS, and a Delta Restore can be performed to any disk that has a previous copy of the image file system, no matter what it is in its current state. So again, it's Macrium Delta Restore is key for any of those who do have maybe sort of more of a blank slate laptop or PC that they are looking to sort of restore an image to, and to get that up and running with their current system as well. And again, it's all about sort of speed and getting yourself prepared for any disaster that could go on. Change block tracker. So Macrium Reflect change block tracker reduces the amount of time it takes to perform incremental and differential images as well by monitoring the changes to an NTFS formatted volume in real time. So once again, one of the key features about Macrium is that in order to perform as well as we do in terms of the software solution, in terms of the speed in which you guys take backups, we do use change block tracker to do that. Jack will go into sort of a little bit more details in terms of how that works for you in terms of using the software and really what the real benefit of using the change block tracker is. Macrium redeployment. So with Macrium Reflect, you can redeploy and restore an image to a replacement computer or even create a virtual hard drive to virtualize the machine, a technique sometimes called physical to virtual or P2V. So redeploy is one of our sort of key features with Macrium software. Once again, just highlighting that it will allow you to restore an image or a backup to any sort of dissimilar hardware from which you originally have been using. So again, we know obviously in the disaster recovery world, you know, it's not always ideal that you've got the exact same laptop or copy of the hardware that you have been using that has been corrupted or has been damaged in any way, and it is a case of that you may need to restore to a completely different hardware system. Macrium Reflect obviously recognizes this and gives you the option in the full license with redeploy of being able to restore to that hardware as well. Again, Jack will probably go over it in a bit more detail in terms of how that feature works. What I'm going to do now is actually just pass over to my colleague Jack, who's going to be going through the demonstration with you guys of those features. So bear me a moment. Right, Jack, feel free to share the screen.
That's great. Thanks, Leo. So as Leo mentioned, I'll be covering some of these in a bit more detail. But obviously, if you do have any questions, just let me know at the end and I'll try and cover it in even more detail in regards to what you've asked. So at the end of the last webinar, assuming that quite a few people here will have seen that, we'd taken an image and a file and folder backup. So that was covering the basics of how to actually start backing up your computer and files. So today we're going to be covering some of the more advanced options that you might not have considered, a couple of the features that Reflect offers that makes your backups fast and secure. So the first feature we'll start with that Leo mentioned before is Change Block Tracker. So what Change Block Tracker is essentially a filter driver that sits in the I/O stack. And then when you perform a full image, it's essentially creating a base point of the disk, and then as incrementals are performed after that, the CBT driver will start to record changes to different sectors on your disk. So then after you've performed an incremental, when the next incremental is performed, instead of having to look at the MFT to start finding changes to your disk and file system, we already have a record of where those changes are, and we can just go straight to them and back them up. So obviously, as we mentioned in the last webinar, the incremental backup will only back up the changes, so this will speed them up a lot. If you navigate to C program files, Macrium, and then Reflect, there's actually a bit of a visual that goes along with the change block tracker, which is the MRCBT tools. So this can be good to just create a bit of a visual of what CBT is actually doing. So down here, we've got a representation of your disk. So these are the different blocks on your disk, and each one's obviously made up of sectors. And then there's a bit of information here about whichever disk you selected. So as you can see here, the amount of changes that have occurred is 2.34 gigabytes. So by looking at this, we can start to get a picture of what the next incremental will actually back up. It will only be backing up these changes here. And then if we click on one of these blocks here, it will give us a bit of a breakdown of the different clusters that are inside there and the files that are located on it. The next feature that Leo mentioned is Macrium Image Guardian. So this is a popular one because it gives you the peace of mind that in the event that something does happen to your system, like a malware, ransomware attack, you've got the peace of mind that your backups will be safe. So especially malware is, ransomware even is particularly relevant recently, as ransomware attacks are becoming one of the most popular forms of cyber attack. So what Image Guardian basically does is it locks down what can access your image file to processes and applications that actually have the Macrium certificate. So if it doesn't have the Macrium certificate, it won't be able to edit your backups. So suppose ransomware starts encrypting files on your disk, Image Guardian will block it. And then when all the files are encrypted on your disk, you can just restore your backup over the top of it. So not only does it protect your images from the ransomware, it's making recovery from that ransomware easier as well. So it's a quick example of Image Guardian here. You can always check the status of your Image Guardian as well by looking either in the Image Guardian settings here, which will tell you the current state of it. But also you'll notice this little shield here on the disk layout. So any disk that is storing a backup will be then protected by Image Guardian while it's enabled. You can manually disable this. There's several reasons you might want to do this. If you want to manually delete backups, we always suggest deleting your backups through Reflect where possible. But if you do it through File Explorer while Image Guardian is on, this will happen. Because since File Explorer hasn't got that Macrium certificate, Image Guardian is just going to block that process. So if we wanted to delete it through File Explorer, we'd have to disable Image Guardian first. And then along with that, in the Image Guardian settings, we also have an events page here, which lists all the events that have occurred, which Image Guardian has blocked. So as you can see here, this is our process that we just launched, unauthorized process of Explorer trying to access the file. So this can give you a bit of information as well. If something is attempting to modify your backups, there's been times where antivirus software has tried to modify backups for whatever reason. And looking in here can help you narrow down what actually is trying to edit your backups. So they're the two main settings that you will want to bear in mind while scheduling your backups and making sure that it is going, your backups are as fast and secure as possible. But as well as this, we also have the Reflect default menu, which contains some additional settings that not everyone considers when trying to streamline their backups. So the main settings in here we'll go through quickly now. There are some additional settings which maybe don't relate as much to backups, but maybe relate more to restores, which I'm sure we'll cover in another webinar at some point. But the first setting here is we have the intelligent sector copy versus the exact copy. So what intelligent sector copy does is it will only back up the sectors of the disk that are actually in use. So an example of this is if you have a hard disk drive, famously, they don't actually delete files when you delete it in the operating system. They'll be marked for deletion, and then they'll just sit around on the disk until a file is written over it. So what intelligent sector copy does is it will ignore those files and only back up the ones that is actually in use by the file system. Whereas making an exact copy, for example, might back up those deleted files because they are still hanging around on your disk. They're just not actually visible to the operating system. So obviously with this setting checked, if you then restore it, those files won't be recovered because they'll still be marked as deleted in the operating system, but they might be carried over to the new drive as well. The next setting here is we have the ability to set a fixed size for our backups. So this is useful, for example, when copying to a CD. If you wanted to, say, copy one of your image files to a CD for an archive, for an example, you wouldn't be able to do it if you've got a full image that's, say, 40-odd gig. But what you could do is go into this setting here and enter a fixed size, which is slightly below the capacity of your CDs. And then, obviously, when this backup is taken, it'll be split into parts. So to then restore it, you will need all the relevant parts of that backup file. The next setting is password protection and AES encryption. So this one's fairly self-explanatory, but what you can do here is encrypt your backups with AES encryption. So while that's enabled, you wouldn't be able to restore or browse the image without providing the password. However, this won't guard against accidental deletion, for example, which Image Guardian does, because although the container is encrypted, it can still be deleted, which is where Image Guardian will come in alongside this to prevent the accidental deletion. An important setting here is the verify images after creation. So when your data has been read from the source of your backup and before it's written to the destination, a hash is created of each block of data. I believe it uses RSA hashing. And what that does is it basically creates a unique hash for each block, which is then stored in the index of your image file when it is written to the destination. So what this setting will do is, at the end of the backup, once the image file has been created, those hashes will be recalculated for the data. If that hash matches the one that was created when it was being read, then you can ensure that that data is exactly the data that was backed up. If those hashes are different, then the data that's now on the destination is not the same as the source disk. This could be due to faulty hardware, if there's been an error transmitting it. So if you've got a faulty disk on the destination or network interference, this could potentially cause the data to change as it's being written. So wherever possible, we'd always advise having this setting just for the peace of mind that it is what is being backed up, essentially. We have the setting here to verify the file system. So what this does is it checks that the NTFS files and folders are mapped correctly to the MFT bitmap or file allocation table. So that's just an extra step to verify the integrity of the file system that is being backed up. We have some additional settings for the custom scripting, which we'll have a bit of a look into in a second. We have the priority here, which can dictate what proportion of system resources is allocated to Reflect backup. So obviously, the higher it is, the faster the backup will be. The lower it is, the slower. But if you have other important tasks running on the system at the same time, you might not want Reflect to take all of those system resources, in which case setting it on the low end will leave more system resources for other applications to use. We have the ability here to cut down on the number of log files that are being kept. You can set the default retention rules here so that when you are creating new backups, these settings will already be automatically applied. You can still change it while creating a new backup, but these will be the defaults in there. There's cloning, as Leo mentioned before, with the rapid delta cloning and intelligent sector copy. So the rapid delta clone will be to an NTFS file system where you've already cloned once. So what that will do is it will compare the file system on the destination, which has already been cloned to, with the file system that you're now cloning to it. And then that way it will only restore the changes from the source to the destination instead of performing a full clone. So this kind of incremental clone can be useful if you want to do hot swapping disks, for example. So if I wanted an emergency disk that I could just take and swap out in case my the disk in my computer breaks, I could just have a regular clone performed to that destination. We have repass points here, whether the repass point will be followed or only the definition of the repass point will be backed up, and backup set matching. So this will just dictate what rules will be applied to file and folder backups, whether a new set will be started or whether it will be appended to an existing file and folder. And finally, in this section, we have the power settings. So what power settings will do, obviously, is you enable it, and then once the backup's completed, it'll go into a power state that you've specified here. So you can have it hibernate or shut down, for example. In the advanced options here, we have some more advanced options. We have the ignore bad sectors. So this will skip over the bad sectors instead of... sorry about that. So normally when it reads bad sector, that will cause the backup to fail. Doing ignore bad sectors here will allow it to continue, but obviously with the bad sectors, we can't ensure the integrity of the actual file system. And you can also have the option here to log for bad sectors so that you know where the actual damage to the disk is. There's some more additional options here. But the main option that people will focus on here is probably the enforced image or folder name. So, for example, normally if you do an incremental backup with this disabled, it will append to the last backup of any type. While this is enabled, it will only append to the last backup with the same name. So doing this will allow you to set custom names when performing a backup, and it will then be followed. The final bit we'll touch on here for this webinar is the actual custom scripting, which is an interesting feature for more advanced users that might want an application or a script to run before or after their backup. A common example of this is, for example, with PowerShell files. We work with, for file synchronization, we use RoboCopy or Robust Copy, which is a Windows feature that's built in. So what you could do is you could have the PowerShell file trigger the robust copy at the end of a backup, meaning that your files will automatically be synchronized from the destination to a third location so that you have got multiple copies of your backups, which is always advised. So when you're doing this, the easiest way is to, once you've got your backup definition file, right click on it and you'll get a load of advanced options here. You can do generate a PowerShell script, and then you can have the run programs that start and end here. I can specify, say, a batch script that I want to run at the end of it. And then at the start of this backup, this batch script will run. There's a lot of different potential applications for this. So generally, we advise just trying it with different scripts to see if to make the backups run more for your situation. And there's a couple of other script types here as well as PowerShell. We have VB script and MS-DOS batch file. With that, I'll pass it over to Leo to finish the remaining slides.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Jack. Right, guys, as mentioned, we are now going to open it up for questions. So anyone that does have any questions, I did see we did have one from Dan Staver in the chat. Dan was just asking, when restoring an image, can you do an asymmetric restore to a larger disk where one or more partitions are enlarged on the restore?
Yeah, that's very easy using Reflect. It'd probably be worth having a webinar dedicated just to restoring at some point, but very briefly, when you're restoring, either through the Rescue Media or through Windows, you do the restore as normal, going through the restore wizard, and then there'll be a page where you can drag the partitions from the image to the target for the restore. Once you've dragged those partitions or copied them over to the restore target, if you look at the bottom, there'll be a button that says restored partition properties. If you select that, you can then enlarge the partitions as much as you want. The main thing to consider with this is that you can only extend partitions to the right of its current location. And as well as that, you can't extend a partition through an existing partition. So it's better to drag them from the source to the from the image to the target of the restore, extend it, and then drag the next partition down.
Thank you. We've also got a question from William Murphy, just asking, are sample scripts available online?
There may be a couple in the knowledge base. There's definitely one for the robocopy that I mentioned before. We have a knowledge base article about using robocopy to synchronize locations. As well as this, though, there is a blog post being written at the minute, which covers scripting and running custom scripts. So if that is something you're interested in, I'd keep an eye out for this blog post, because there will be a few examples of different scripts that you can run.
And for any that don't know where to find it, if you guys go to the Macrium website and click on the support tab, you will see the link for our knowledge base, which basically is our ultimate user guide for Macrium software. So you can search a lot of the features and a lot of information in there as well, if there's anything particular that you're looking for. Again, we have a follow-up question from Brian. Brian, just to answer your question in terms of the difference between a clone and an image, we did actually cover this in the last webinar. In fact, we have a webinar dedicated to cloning, so you can find more detail in there if you're looking at that in particular. But when you are cloning, you are basically restoring or cloning anything and everything that's on your machine, but you're also cloning onto a disk that, if it has got anything on it, will basically be wiped off. So we always say that if you are looking to clone, make sure there's nothing on the hard disk you're looking to clone to, because that will be completely gone if you are looking to clone. But you can find a more detailed answer in our previous webinars. You can find those webinars on our YouTube page or on the Macrium website as well. Just moving on, we've got a question from Raymond about how to skip bad sectors from the source disk.
So that was in the Reflect defaults menu that we saw before. So what you do is you go into Reflect other tasks, for example, and then do edit defaults. And if you go along to the advanced tab and advanced backup options, the first option at the top is ignore bad sectors when creating images. So this will, instead of failing when it hits a bad sector, it will potentially continue. I believe it does depend on how many bad sectors and how much damage has actually occurred to the source disk. But again, I generally wouldn't really recommend this, because when you're getting bad sectors on the source disk, it's implying that there is actual damage to the source disk. So when it comes to restoring that, you will potentially have lost data that was located in those bad sectors.
Perfect. Thank you, Jack. We have a question from Elisha. I do apologize if I pronounced that wrong. Can you create an image from HP desktop PC and apply the image to a Dell or Acer PC? So I think just asking about sort of the redeploy feature maybe in that regard.
Generally, you shouldn't have any issues restoring, backing up one computer and restoring to another. The only issue that you frequently run into is when it comes to hardware that has specialist drivers. So Windows actually ships with a bunch of generic drivers. So for a lot of SATA drives and hard disk, for most hardware like SATA drives and USB devices, there's normally a generic driver which will allow that to talk to your operating system. But in some cases, hardware will actually have a specialist driver that goes along with it. So suppose you have an NVMe drive. Windows doesn't normally ship with a driver to talk to that drive. So in that case, you'd need a specialist driver, which is where ReDeploy comes in. So suppose that HP desktop was restored to the Acer. But it didn't have the correct drivers. You'd add the drivers to the rescue media, run redeploy, and it'd inject it into your Windows operating system to allow it to boot.
Perfect, Jack. Owen, you can ask a question using mic. I just want to get through Laura's question first. And then feel free, if you do have a question, you can use the mic to ask it. And then we'll get through the rest of the questions in the chat before moving on. So, quickly, just Laura's questions. The incremental backups do not overwrite the previous file data. I'm wondering if I could make a choice to restore from a date earlier than the most recent incremental file.
There's no issues restoring from a previous incremental. So how it basically works is you create the full, and that's everything that's on that disk or partition, whichever it is you specified. Then as you continue to use your system, there's going to be changes to files, system files. So to make sure that you've got a more recent backup, you perform an incremental, which basically takes only the changes that have occurred since the last backup. So suppose you took a full and then an incremental. The next incremental will only contain the changes since the last incremental. When it comes time to restoring it, you just pick whichever one in the backup set you want to restore to. So it could be a backup from a couple of months ago, a couple of weeks ago. You can restore that and it will restore it to the point in time that incremental was created at.
Perfect, thank you. Owen, yeah, if you want to take the opportunity to ask your question.
Thank you. Thank you. So if you're using Guardian, do you need to encrypt as well?
With so Image Guardian and encryption are kind of protecting against two different things, I'd say. So if you want complete security, you could use the AES encryption and Image Guardian. So the AES encryption is going to stop unauthorized access to your images. So suppose someone else is using your computer and they try and browse that image to take valuable data out of it or restore it to another system without your permission. Doing the AES encryption will put a passphrase on that. So unless they've got that passphrase, they won't be able to restore it. Whereas Image Guardian is going to protect against the accidental deletion and modification by a third party. So that's
Yes.
mainly aimed at third party software such as ransomware or accidental deletion as well.
So local versus remote attempts, basically.
That's one way of looking at it if you boil it down. So if you want more of a complete protection for your image, you can use the AES encryption and Image Guardian. We'd always advise using Image Guardian anyway, because it's if something does happen to your system, you want to ensure that those images are protected. So wherever possible, I'd leave Image Guardian enabled.
I was reading an article where there was encryption can be encrypted again. So even if you encrypted the file to protect yourself and you did have ransomware, that particular file could be encrypted again a second time. So the encryption is basically a waste of time.
Nice. Encryption doesn't protect against being encrypted again, as you said, because basically what encryption is doing is taking the data and then scrambling it using a set of algorithms. So once it's been scrambled and you've got that AES encrypted backup, another encryption standard could come along and just scramble the data again, and then it's been encrypted by ransomware. And that's where Image Guardian comes in, because if you've got it encrypted and Image Guardian's enabled, nothing would be able to re-encrypt it because it's been protected at that point.
And is that protected from Image Guardian from remote and also email? In other words, like if you were to open up an email, would that encrypt and then take away? In other words, uninstall itself and then you'd be screwed, or it would protect that because it's actually a program running within the computer itself. So it's kind of like you taking you installing a program in your machine. So if you could install a program in a machine, can't the ransomware install itself into the machine and override?
Yeah, so if the ransomware's installed on your system, which is normally how ransomware does attack, normally it's some kind of application. It installs this ransomware encrypting algorithm, and then it starts just randomly encrypting your files. That wouldn't affect the backups, because unless it's actually got the Macrium certificate on it, Image Guardian will shut it down. So only something that's got this Macrium certificate and is signed by us will be able to access the backup. So it doesn't really matter if someone's trying to encrypt it remotely or whether it's a local something installed on the machine itself, it'll still be stopped by MIG.
Cool.
Right, just going to get Aaron, what was you saying quickly?
So I have a couple of questions, but if other people have, then let them take their turns.
Yeah, I just want to get through the last couple of questions in the chat as well, just to keep no one waiting, and then we'll move on. But if you do have any further questions, as mentioned, please do email them into sales@macrium.com, and we're happy to have a look at them as well. So just following on in regards to Mark's question, if I have an image created on a 512 gigabyte SSD / HDD with only 180 gigabytes of data, is it possible to restore said image to a smaller drive, such as a 256 gigabyte SSD / HDD?
Yeah, you wouldn't have any issues doing that. So if you do copy selected partitions, it will be automatically resized when it's restored, or you can manually drag the partitions from the image to the destination for the restore and then resize them yourself. As long as the total used space that's being backed up is smaller than the destination disk, then you won't have any issues performing that restore.
Perfect. And it looks like we've got two questions from Dan. Dan, I'm going to do your first question and then move on to the next questions below you. So Dan was initially to say, restoring from earlier backups saved me after MS Push updated trashed his computer time. Unfortunately, RIT was not able to help me, so he's restored until the fourth older image, which was free of the bad update, which kept updating to a bad push. That's okay, great feedback. Thank you, Dan. And Dan also asking, is there a way to check if his backup files already have Macrium Image Guardian protecting them?
Yeah, so as I briefly mentioned before touching it again, when you open Reflect, if you go to the backup tab and create a backup, you'll see a breakdown of all of your disks, which will most likely include the destination for your backups, which would be, say, another internal drive or a USB hard disk. As long as it's got that little Image Guardian symbol on it, then it is being protected. So any Macrium image on that drive will be safe.
Perfect. Cheers, Jack. And we've got 2 points from Peter, just saying how to clone or image an encrypted drive without having the password, and is it possible to use viBoot for VMware?
So viBoot at the minute doesn't work with VMware. If you wanted to restore your image to VMware, what we'd suggest doing is creating a virtual machine on your VMware hypervisor, so probably VMware Exe. Once you've got that blank virtual machine, if you create a rescue media ISO, attach it to the virtual machine, boot it into the rescue environment, you can restore your image to it. So it will take quite a bit longer than doing it the viBoot way, but currently this is the best way to do physical to virtual migration using VMware. For more detailed steps, we actually have a blog post detailing the exact steps you'd need to take to do that, which I believe is blog.macrium.com, I think. But yeah, if you go to that, that will contain the detailed steps. What was the other question? Sorry.
So the first point that Peter was mentioning was just how to clone or image an encrypted drive without having a password.
Okay, so we'll use BitLocker as an example. The only normal way, so suppose it's your C drive, you'd be imaging it from the rescue media, since you wouldn't be able to boot into it without unencrypting it. But suppose it is like a secondary drive that's encrypted and you've backed it up, it will be backed up in its encrypted state. So this will take longer because we can't read the data that's contained inside the encrypted drive. So it's backed up in its encrypted state. So it will, it's basically going to take, the backup will take as long as if the drive is full of data. So we'll back it up as if it's full. When it comes to restoring it, it will be restored the same way. So it will be restored in encrypted state as well. So for an example, if you've backed up your C drive while it was encrypted with BitLocker and it's in a lock state, it will be restored in a lock state as well. So then the next time you boot into it, you would have to provide that key to unencrypt it. This will be the same for all encryption types, I'm assuming, because just to ensure the integrity of encryption. If we did back it up and then restored it unencrypted, then that would undermine the security of the encryption, essentially. There are a couple of caveats on that. We have a knowledge base article on BitLocker restore outcomes. So, for example, if you back it up while it's unlocked and restore it to another disk, it will be restored as if there's no encryption on it, and you'd have to re-encrypt that drive.
Okay, perfect. I'm just going to do the final question here, guys. Just Hamilton Walker just is saying, is it better to clone or image if they're looking to upgrade from Windows 7, for instance, to Windows 10?
Sorry, what was that?
So he's just saying, is it cloning or imaging to do a backup of Windows 7 to upgrade to Windows 10? So I think Hamilton's looking at obviously upgrading his Windows package to Windows 10, and just wants to know if it's probably better to either image or clone.
So imaging or cloning won't update your operating system, but I'd suggest performing an image, an actual backup of your operating system before you upgrade, just give you the peace of mind. When Windows 10 first came out, I remember there was a lot of issues with people's computers actually getting bricked occasionally when they went from, say, Windows 7 to Windows 10. So definitely having that backup before you update is a very good idea. But if you restore your C drive from a Windows 7 machine and restore it to a Windows 10 machine, for example, the Windows 10 machine will go back to being Windows 7 because you've restored the Windows 7 operating system onto it.
Perfect. Thank you, Jack. Guys, any further questions? Oh, is that Michael?
Sorry. Can I squeeze one in here? Just a quick one here.
Go on. You got the last one.
Can you use VirtualBox to run the backup as a temporary instead of using Hyper-V?
Yeah. So again, this will be the P2V migration. It doesn't work with ViBoot at the minute. So what you'd have to do again is create a virtual machine in VirtualBox. Put in your rescue media ISO and then do the restore that way. But that will, the end result will be a virtual machine that's had your image restored to it. So that virtual machine will be at the point in time that that image was created.
So you create the virtual box ready to go and then just unleash the, restore the backup to that.
Yeah, essentially. If you go to the other tasks and create rescue media in Reflect, you'll notice that there's an option to create an ISO. That is primarily used when in accordance with a virtual machine. So you can just attach that ISO and it will boot you into the rescue environment.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jack. I appreciate that.
No worries.
As mentioned, any other questions, please do email into sales@macrium.com. We'll have a look. Do apologize that we haven't been able to get through everything today. Just to finish off, I just want to highlight some of the other products that Macrium have as well, in case some of them may be of interest to you guys. So we currently have Site Manager, which is our central management tool. For those of you that use multiple PCs within the workplace, school, or any environment like that, you know, Site Manager will basically allow you to attach Macrium agents to those PCs you're looking to take regular backups, and also manage the backup schedule for all of those PCs as well, so you're not having to go to every single one individually. And Site Manager is sort of internet-based, so you can run Site Manager tool off any computer. You're not restricted just having sort of one PC to do that from. Multi-site is also a great tool for taking that to the next level in regards to Site Manager. Multi-site will actually allow you to manage several different sites. Again, for any of those, any of you guys that do work in companies that you've got, you know, sites at different locations, and you still want to manage the backups for all of those different sites, multi-site will basically allow you to do so through Site Manager. So again, managing all those individual sites through Site Manager and bring it under one umbrella again. The deployment kit, of course, is a fantastic tool for those who are looking at sort of deploying a golden image to several machines. So again, if you do have the case of having to set up 50, 20, 100 machines using obviously the same image, so they're all processed the same way, the deployment kit will allow you to do that. It does run Macrium off a bootable USB stick, so you're not installing it on every single machine. And it will allow you to actually create up to five USB sticks, portable USB sticks to do so as well. So if you do have help or other technicians that may need to do similar type of job, the deployment kit is great for that. The technicians is a fantastic one-on-one tool as well, in regards to allowing you to run Macrium off a portable USB stick. So if you're a technician and you do have to go out to certain clients and you are fixing the machines, it will allow you to obviously to, take images and restore using the USB stick. So once again, you're not installing Macrium on every single machine that you're working on. You can find more details on our website, macrium.com, of any of these products. Or once again, if you've got any questions, do feel free to email into sales@macrium.com. Guys, you will find all of our webinar videos on our YouTube channel and also our resources page as well. On our blog, you'll find a lot of information in terms of keeping your data safe and backing up your information, obviously during our current climate with coronavirus. There are some very interesting articles there that may be of interest and will help you guys during this time. So do please visit the Macrium website, visit the blog and our resources, and you'll find a lot of our webinar videos that we have done previously. Once again, guys, after this webinar, you will be able to find a copy at least by tomorrow of this webinar on our YouTube channel as well. But apart from that, I just want to thank everyone for joining. Thank you guys for the questions as well. You know, we always find that they are useful to anyone else that have either missed the webinar or have similar questions that they wanted to ask. And yeah, guys, do keep in touch. Any other questions, as mentioned, do email to sales@macrium. And thank you for joining us.